So good afternoon, and we are going to start a very interesting session. That's on refractive surgery. With me, we have Dr. Rajiv Chaudhary. Is not your Dr. O.P. Agarwal is here. Dr. Krishna Murthy is here. Dr. Malay Chaturvedi is. Yeah, please come, sir. Dr. Sohail Irfan. Dr. Sohail Irfan. Yeah. So we are going to start the session, and the talk is for 6 minutes. We are a little short of time, so I request every member to be on time. Sir, please.
We'll start with the session. Invite Dr. Sheetal Prath. Shaura Ramukha. Ramukha. With her presentation, next generation 3D epithelial thickness. Is it? Come. What is her, your topic? So we'll start with paper 10 because she has got another presentation in the next session. So we'll start with one. Dr. Sirakshi Dhur, she will present intraoperative wavefront tapirometry in radial keratotomy, post radial keratotomy, cataract patients. Okay, doctor, you can proceed.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Sirakshi here presenting on the topic of intraoperative wavefront tapirometry in post radial keratotomy cataract patients. We all know that post-RK cataracts have difficult IL power calculation. RK alters the normal corneal curvature and anterior-posterior relationship. This alteration is different to laser refractive surgery. The optic zone is generally less than 3 mm. The standard K is going to overestimate the corneal power and result in eventual hyperopia. Irregular corneas with multiple steep and flat areas are also common, and intraoperative opening of radial incisions may cause post-operative instability. The conventional methods for IL power calculation include double K method, SRKT Holiday 1 with an ASCRS online calculator, standard Hagee's formula, etc. These methods involve an estimation of central K and ELP, and the outcomes are variable. We know that ORA, which is Optiwave Refractive Analysis, it provides intraoperative IL power calculation using a SLED system. A superluminescent light-emitting diode is used, and a Talbot-Moyer interferometry is performed. This interferometry generates a fringe pattern which finds out the sphere, cylinder and the axis. It has been found to be more accurate in challenging eyes such as prior LASIK and PRK, but there is no published literature comparing conventional methods with intraoperative aberrometry in post-RK eyes. So that's the aim of our study, to find the accuracy of intraoperative wavefront aberrometry with conventional methods in post-RK cataract patients. It was a prospective comparative study held at Dr. Rajendra Prasad Center for Ophthalmic Sciences from July 2017 to April 2019. Patients with prior history of RK and nucleus sclerosis up to grade 2 were included who gave consent for the surgery. Patients with the previous intraocular surgery not willing to participate or a follow-up less than 1 month were not included. This was the flowchart for methodology. A total of 30 eyes of 18 patients were recruited. 18 had RK with standard 8 incisions and 12 had more than 8 incisions. The IL power was calculated using Holiday 1 with ASCRS calculator as conventional method. Intraoperative wavefront aberrometry was performed using ORA in aphakic mode with a chamber filled with OVD with IOP more than 21. And IL power was chosen with this surgeon's choice method or combined method.
Patient data entry with selection of post-RK more than 8 cuts mode is made. After removal of nuclear and cortical matter, anterior chamber is formed with viscoelastic to raise IOP to adequate levels. Aberrometry is performed in aphakic mode. Patient has to look at the red target light at this time. After IL is calculated, IL of chosen power is implanted by the surgeon.
So that was the intraoperative aberrometry. Coming on to the results of the study, the mean age was 45.4 years, gender was 66% female, preoperative uncorrected distance visual acuity was 1.1 logmar, CDVA was 0.25 logmar units, spherical equivalent was -4.25, axial length 26.11 and mean keratometry of 39.41. The uncorrected distance visual acuity improved from 1.1 to 0.32 logmar units postoperatively, and corrected distance visual acuity improved from 0.25 to 0.19 logmar units postoperatively. Spherical equivalent also reduced postoperatively from 3.45 to 0.45, and the keratometry showed no significant change with 38.94 postoperatively. The IL power calculated with the three methods were selected. Conventional method gave a mean of 21.4 diopters, ORA gave 23.7 diopters, and the IL implanted was 23.9 diopters. A chi-square test was performed between the three methods, and the power was not found to be significant in any of the cases. The mean prediction error for implanted IL power was calculated as the difference between the originally targeted refraction and post-operative outcome for conventional method as well as ORA. A total mean prediction error and mean prediction error in group 1, which was 8 incision group, was found to be not significant. But mean prediction error in group 2, which was RK with more than 8 incisions, was found to be significant, p-value 0.04. The percentage of the patients within 0.5 or 1 diopter of predicted spherical equivalent is shown in this table. On the left, the graph shows the 0.5 diopter range and 0.1 diopter range for ORA and conventional method as well as the IL implanted. These were not found to be significant. The percentage of patients within 1 diopter of predicted spherical equivalent is shown on the right graph with two groups, 8 incisions and more than 8 incisions. The only value found significant in this analysis, subgroup analysis, was conventional versus ORA, which was found to have a p-value of 0.31, which was statistically significant. I would like to share one study before concluding. This was a study done on multifocal ILs after RK. The study concluded the surgical accuracy of 29% eyes of 0.5 diopter and 65% within 1 diopter. So they showed almost comparable errors as compared to our study, and they concluded that the RK is not a good choice for multifocal ILs. That means we are still not there yet. There was a single case report published on ORA analysis in post-RK patients. They found it was not performing well since in their surgery there was significant corneal edema intraoperatively due to hard cataract. We have selected an inclusion criteria of NS grade up to 2. So we did not encounter this problem. I would like to conclude that conventional methods and ORA perform equally well in 8 incisions RK patients, but ORA has a better ability to predict IL power in more than 8 incisions. Hence, ORA can be used in post-RK cataract patients for better refractive results, while none of the methods overall guarantees 100% efficacy. The limitation of our study is a small sample size, especially in more than 8 incisions, which was 12 eyes. A larger sample size study should validate the results. Thank you.
Next speaker, I invite Dr. Siddhi Goyal to present her paper on assessment of implantable collamer lens ICL vault using a modified posterior segment OCT.
Next presenter.
Siddhi Goyal, last one. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Siddhi Goyal. I'm here to present my free paper titled Assessment of ICL Vault Using a Posterior Segment OCT. There are no financial disclosures. So I'd like to introduce by discussing about ICL, which is the implantable collamer lens. It's a type of a posterior chamber phakic IOL, which is used for correction of myopia as well as hyperopia. I'd also like you to understand what is the ICL vault. It is the space between the posterior surface of the ICL and the anterior surface of the crystalline lens, and we target an ideal vault of 250 to 750 microns. So this is a slit lamp image which shows us the ICL vault. Here if we see the space between the yellow arrows, that is the asterisk, is the ICL vault. And this is the corresponding anterior segment OCT which we routinely do in our post-op patients to assess the ICL vaulting. So why is vaulting important? Excessive vaulting that is greater than 750 microns, which could result as a result of larger sized ICL and can lead to angle crowding in glaucoma, which we can again see in the image that is presented down. And insufficient vaulting, which is less than 250 microns, which could result as a smaller size ICL and can lead to increased risk of cataractogenesis and pigment dispersion. So the aim of a study was to correlate the ICL vault between a standard anterior segment OCT and the modified posterior segment OCT. So how did we modify the posterior segment OCT? The routinely used posterior segment OCT was modified by placing a 20 diopters biconvex lens along its scanning aperture. This adjustment is able to scan the anterior segment structures by inducing extra convergence, thereby allowing effortless imaging of the anterior segment structures right from the corneal apex to the posterior capsule of the lens. So this is just an image. We see the examiner's view of the posterior segment OCT that we used, and this is the scanning aperture where we have secured a 20 diopter lens using a micropore. Thus, 16 eyes of 8 patients underwent vaulting assessment using the standard AS OCT as well as the modified posterior segment OCT. So coming to the results, the mean age of 8 patients that were included in our study was 26 years. The mean ICL vault as seen on AS OCT was 586 microns, whereas on the modified OCT, it was 596 microns, which resulted in a mean difference of 9.8 microns, which came out to be statistically significant. However, this minute difference could be attributed to subtle deviations in the selection points or any other unknown errors. This is a representative image which we acquired on the modified posterior segment OCT. Here, as we see, the yellow arrow represents the posterior surface of the ICL and the red arrow is the anterior capsule of the crystalline lens, and the distance between these two represents the ICL vault. These are similar images which were acquired in the other patients and how we calculated the vaulting. Also, I would like to just highlight a study from our center, which was again for ICL vaulting, which we use a smartphone macro lens combination for ICL vaulting. It was a simple tool to assess the ICL vault. Here, as we see, there's a macro lens which was clipped onto a camera, a routine phone, and then this is the anterior segment slit lamp image that we acquired through this combination, and a magnified image of the same, which was we use the ImageJ software to calculate the ICL vaulting. Thus, I'd like to conclude by saying, on posterior segment OCT with simple modifications, ICL vaulting can be quantified with great accuracy. Therefore, this modality is a no-cost modification and can be used as an alternative tool in place of AS OCT during post-operative period. It is a simple and inexpensive modification which can be used as a comprehensive ophthalmic imaging tool for both anterior and posterior segment evaluation. The limitation of this modification is the lack of the ability of the machine to image the anterior chamber depth in one scan. Thank you.
One or two comments.
Yes.
Number one, I think it is mentioned in the guidelines that you should not mention your institute while doing a presentation, especially if it is to be counted for a marking. That's okay. Number one. Number two, for all the contestants, we have indicator in your thing, so if you want to show, you can actually show that. And this concept of introducing a plus 20 lens to OCT has been presented previously in various presentations, and this sounds to be a very good idea. And what you showed with your smartphone thing,
yes, sir.
I think we are heading towards that AI thing, for which actually you are going to incorporate these lenses in the smartphone itself.
Right.
So actually you can do your auto photograph. So we should not be very happy about it, because it's going to take some of our work out of it. So be very careful. I think it was a nice presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Doctor, how many cases you did it like this?
Sir, total number. There were 16 eyes, 8 60. Patients we included at one point in time whenever they came in the follow-up period.
Okay.
So we compared both the modalities together, AS OCT and the modified OCT.
So next speaker, invite Dr. Sweta Patrao. She will be presenting the paper on management of high astigmatism keratoconus post CXL and keratoplasty with phakic lenses.
A very good afternoon to everyone. I'm Dr. Shweta, and I'll be speaking about the management of high astigmatism in keratoconus post C3R and keratoplasty with phakic lenses. So as we all know, post-keratoplasty and post-C3R, the visual acuity remains poor in a few patients because of the residual high myopia and astigmatism. Thus, additional interventions are often necessary to improve the vision. The use of contact lenses and spectacles is usually limited because of the presence of the dry eye, peripheral corneal vascularization, ametropia, anisometropia, and the aberrations. Thus, how do you correct this high astigmatism? Posterior chamber phakic intraocular lenses is one option, and in our study we have used two types of phakic intraocular lens. One is the ICL and one is the RIL. The RIL is a refractive implantable lens. So the major difference between the two is RIL is an Indian make, and it is made from hydrophilic acrylic material, and it has an it is customizable. So in case of the ICL, we can correct astigmatism up to -4 diopters, whereas in this, it can be customized based on the white-to-white measurement and also the astigmatism of the patient. And the cost, RIL is around half the price of ICL. We had three objectives in our study. The primary objective was to study the efficacy and safety of the phakic lens in correcting ametropia following the C3R and the post-keratoplasty. The safety is assessed based on the complications, and the efficacy is based on the visual outcome. The secondary objective was to study the visual outcome in the two groups of cases, that is the post-C3R and the post-keratoplasty. And the tertiary objective was to study the visual outcomes of the two types of lenses that were used, that is the ICL and the RIL. So this was a retrospective case study with a sample size of 36 eyes of 28 patients. The inclusion criteria were patients with a stable refractive error post-C3R and stable refractive error post-keratoplasty who came for regular follow-up 1 year post-op. The exclusion criteria was who all had an anterior chamber depth of less than 3 mm, media opacities, history of keratitis or any other ocular morbidities, and endothelial cell density less than 2,200 cells in post-C3R cases and less than 1,800 in post-keratoplasty cases. So pre-op, the detailed ophthalmic examination of the patient was done, and after obtaining consent, the phakic IOL was implanted. Follow-up was conducted at the first month, 6 month, and 12 month, and during the follow-up, the visual acuity was corrected, uncorrected, and best corrected. The vault height, intraocular pressure, corneal endothelial count, and the slit lamp examination was done. So out of the 36 eyes of the 28 patients, 12 were females and 16 were males. The average age was around 26.9 plus or minus 9 years. The mean follow-up was around 16 plus or minus 5 months. 8 patients were having underwent a bilateral implantation, and 20 patients underwent a unilateral implantation. So out of the 36 eyes, 25 were post-C3R cases, and 11 were post-keratoplasty cases. Out of the C3R cases, 76% were implanted with the ICL, and keratoplasty cases, 81% were implanted with RIL. The choice of the lenses was mostly based on the affordability of the patient and also the customization, like if their white-to-white was not available in the optic size was not available. So coming to the primary objective, that is the efficacy, we found there was a very significant improvement in the uncorrected visual acuity with the p-value being less than 0.01%. There was no complications. We didn't note any case of infectious keratitis, lens rotation, vaulting problems, cataract formation, pigment dispersion. There was not a very significant endothelial cell loss or significant increase in the intraocular pressure, and the vault size was more than 500 micrometers. So coming to the secondary objective, wherein we wanted to know the visual outcomes in both the groups, we found that the corrected visual acuity post-op was better than the uncorrected visual acuity post-op was better than the best corrected visual acuity pre-op. So the reason of this is probably because since the phakic IOL is present near the nodal point, the aberrations are reduced, and also the minification by the spectacles is overcome. So in the post C3R cases, a -2 to minus cylinder was corrected, and the average cylinder was from -4.1, it reduced to -0.8. Similar visual outcomes were seen in the post-keratoplasty cases, and the cylinder was corrected from -2.5 to -9, where an average of -5.5 was reduced to -0.59. At the end of 12 months, we saw that, as already mentioned, that there was a significant improvement in the visual acuity, and there was a significant drop in the spherical equivalence. Coming to the visual outcomes of both the phakic lenses, we again found that the uncorrected visual acuity at the end of 1 month was better than the target logMA, that is the best corrected visual acuity pre-op, with p-value being significant. So there was a similar study done by Farlaha et al. In the post-keratoplasty, in the post-C3R cases, and they found that there was a significant drop in the significant improvement in the visual acuity like ours. And Shafiq Shaheen et al. Conducted a similar case wherein the spherical equivalent was significantly improved, just like ours, similar to ours. In a study conducted by Alfonso JF et al., what they found was the post of uncorrected visual acuity was almost same as the pre-op corrected visual acuity. But in our study, it was better. So the reason of this would have been that in their study, they used a off-the-rack ICL. So they could correct the astigmatism only a particular limit, and once it reached above the limit, they had to take the spherical equivalent. But since we've used a custom-made toric IOL, probably the visual acuity was better in ours. So what was known in this study was that phakic IOL were used to correct high myopia and astigmatism, but its use was never studied in the Asian population. And what this study adds is that they are safe and effective in correcting high refractive error in post C3R and keratoplasty cases with custom-made toric refractive impartible lens can correct astigmatism up to -9 and may be considered as an alternate for the Indian market. The limitations of the study are it was a small sample size, and the other aspects like the aberrations were not taken into consideration because of the not having the wavefront aberrometry machine in our hospital. And the future aspects are trials with larger sample size need to be done with a long-term follow-up. And the study and studies need to be done to compare the refractive outcomes of ICL versus RIL in the same group of cases with high astigmatism. So I conclude the study by saying that phakic IOL is an effective and safe method of improving the visual acuity and reducing the refractive error in both the groups with high myopia and astigmatism, provided that they have a good best corrected visual acuity. Thank you.
So how many cases you come across the secondary glaucoma, raised intraocular pressure? You have mentioned no raised in the intraocular pressure.
In our study, we didn't have any patients.
Your study, no yes, raised sir. Intraocular pressure.
No significant rise, sir. There was just two.
Significance means?
There was 2 mmHg increase, sir.
Only
but it
2
was
mm.
Not, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Now I invite Dr. Isha Agarwal. She is going to present a paper on corneal stromal and nerve changes following LASIK using in vivo confocal microscopy. And
kya ho raha hai dada A very good afternoon to this August gathering. My topic for discussion today is analysis of corneal stromal and nerve changes following LASIK using in vivo confocal microscopy. I have no financial disclosure or any conflicts of interest. The main objectives to carry out this study were to analyze the corneal stromal and nerve changes following LASIK using in vivo confocal microscopy under the following parameters: the keratocyte density in the anterior and posterior stromal layers, the flap thickness, hexagonal cell numbers, corneal nerve changes, pre and post LASIK and their regeneration. So now what we already know is cornea is a transparent avascular watch glass like structure contributing to nearly 3/4 of the refractive power of the cornea. And microscopically it is divided into 5 layers, and the changes are mainly noted in the epithelium, stromal and the stromal nerve plexus. And now coming to the in vivo confocal microscopy. In vivo confocal microscopy allows visualization of all layers of the cornea in details. It scans the epithelial layer, intermediate epithelial cells, basal epithelial cells, the nerve plexus, and the stroma and the stromal keratocytes. And now coming to our study that was conducted at Sri Shankardev Netralaya Guwahati, which was a prospective non-randomized observational study carried over a period of 2 years, which included 80 patients undergoing myopic LASIK surgery who have had a stable refractive power for at least a year. The patients included in our study were patients presenting with myopic correction for 0.5 to 9 diopter and had stable refraction for at least a year, patient presenting with regular astigmatism of up to 1.5 diopters, aged between 25 to 35 years, and consent forms were to be duly signed. The excluded patients were who refused to give consent, patient presenting with unstable vital signs, history or previous surgery, unmotivated patients, patients with ocular abnormalities such as keratoconus, glaucoma, dry eye. And all the surgical procedures were carried out at our institution, Sri Shankardev Netralaya, with the help of a microkeratom, where flap thickness of 120 microns were created, and thereby ablation of stroma was carried out by excimer laser. And after the surgical procedure were done, the patient was positioned in front of the confocal microscope, maintaining a near perfect alignment with the plus 40 diopter lens. And when the alignment was near to perfection, a total of 350 images were obtained on the screen, scanning the cornea anterior to posteriorly. And to quantitatively analyze our parameters, we had computer software, the Z-ring and optical pachymetry, that measured the distance between endothelial and epithelial peak in each scan to get the optical pachymetry. And we had the automated endothelial cell analysis to measure the endothelial cell density. And to qualitatively analyze our findings, the investigators studied the image and studied it quantitatively. And these examinations were carried out preoperatively and postoperatively 1 week, 1 month, and 3 months postoperatively. And now it is about time we wait for the healing to occur and see what are the results we've obtained. So out of 144 eyes of 72 patients who had undergone the LASIK refractive surgery, maximum patients were seen in the age group of 21 to 25 years of age who had a spherical equivalent that ranged from minus 5 diopteric sphere to minus 13.5 spherical diopter. The mean ablation depth has showed a significant relation with the keratocyte density. The anterior stroma that included the highest population density of keratocytes in the stroma, the high density was partially or completely removed by excimer laser. As we can see in this picture, preoperatively the density was 20,660, which reduced in the postoperative first week, and we could see significant increase in the keratocyte density showing regeneration of the stromal keratocytes. Also, keratocyte activation was seen in 79.2% of the patients, which were noted as brightly reflective keratocyte nuclei in the anterior stroma that were associated with prominent interconnecting cell processes. Now coming to a flap thickness, the mean flap thickness noted were 111 in the patients. And now nerve plexus orientation, the appearance of the nerve fibers were bright, well-defined linear structure that was sometimes branched or usually appeared in severe consecutive frame. Since this was a qualitative analysis in our study, we could not see any nerve plexus in 41% of the patients. Subepithelial plexus were noted in 23.6% of the patients, and subepithelial and basal plexus were noted in 35.4% of the patients. And now coming to the post-operative evaluation, in the 1 week period, we did not see any nerve plexus in 66.7%, and peripheral regeneration was noted in 33% of the patients. And in the 1 month post-operative period, we could see central fibers in 16.7, central and peripheral in 41.7, and peripheral fibers in 41.7% of the patients. So as we know, wound healing being a complicated process is not studied in depth if the patient does not present with the complaint post-surgery. But in our study, we present a longitudinal study with in vivo confocal microscopy to study the normal healing process, LASIK being the leading surgical procedure for correction of various types of ametropia and surgical wounding by excimer laser, alters the normal structure, cellularity, and innervation of the cornea. As we know that cornea on being wounded, there occurs migration, mitosis and differentiation, and when there occurs differentiation of keratocytes to myofibroblasts, that leads to the process of regeneration. In this picture, we see the initial keratocyte loss after the LASIK triggers a subsequent proliferation of the keratocyte. Increased keratocyte density is noted in the middle and the posterior stromal layers. This is the stromal reaction that was evaluated by a stromal scatter. This is the qualitative analysis of nerve plexus that was noted. We can see beaded appearance of the nerve fibers. The limitations we faced in this study were limited area was under observation. There was lack of registration of the area which was scanned and inter-observer variability that approaches to 8%. Thus, I would like to conclude by saying following LASIK, the normal anatomical and physiological corneas heal well by the fibroblast activity as seen in the keratocyte. The flap creation and stromal ablation cause insult to the stromal keratocyte, which then induces apoptosis and stimulate fibroblasts to form newer activated keratocytes and healing occurs. The nerve plexus disrupted also seen to regenerate following the surgery. Thank you.
So do you think that neural regeneration is there following the process?
Thank you for the question, sir. So the only part of cornea that does not regenerate is the endothelium. And what we have noted in our study that the keratocytes and the nerve plexus, they well regenerate after the any sort of insult. So the insult we've studied here is the excimer LASIK, excimer laser basically. So we've seen regeneration of nerve plexus, but since this was not a quantitative analysis, it was a qualitative analysis. We have seen regeneration in different frames, like coming from the periphery, coming from the center, and in few pictures we had noticed central and peripheral regeneration of the nerve fibers.
The purpose of asking this question was traditionally we think that nerves don't regenerate. That is the common impression we have.
Yes, sir. But in confocal they give a good visualization.
In cornea you said there is some activity.
Yes, sir.
Which is showing. So whether it is a active nerve or not active nerve, that we don't know, but yes, some structural
yeah. And sir, previous studies have also shown that the regenerated nerves show a beaded appearance. Like they are not the straight branch, I mean straight appearing nerve. They are more beaded, they are more branched, and they don't have a well-defined pattern. And so.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
The next speaker is Dr. Isha Agarwal, and the topic is corneal, stromal, and this is what we're doing. Okay, so Dr. Nilesh Kumar will present on refractive outcomes of collagen cross-linking for post-refractive surgery ectasia.
Good afternoon, everybody. Respected judges, seniors, and my colleagues. I'm Dr. Nilesh Kumar, and I'm going to talk about refractive outcomes of collagen cross-linking for post-refractive surgery keratoectasia or iatrogenic keratoectasia. There is no financial disclosure to be made. It is a rare but vision-threatening serious complication which follows an uneventful keratorefractive procedure. And it was first reported by Sailor et al. In 1998. And since then, in all of the keratorefractive procedures, it has been reported. It can be defined as post-LASIK progressive corneal thinning with a steepening mainly inferiorly with loss of BCVA, similar to early keratoconus. The incidence ranges from 0.04 to 0.6%, but AIA has concluded that the correct incidence can't be predicted. There is no proven pathogenesis, but disruption of composite materials in biomechanically weakened cornea, which we induce by the laser, can be the cause. So the risk factor includes deep ablation, stromal bed thickness of residual thickness of less than 250, retreatments from first keratoconus or PMDs. So the current treatment options available are rigid gas permeable lens, but they are not attacking the pathogenesis. They are not treating the pathogenesis. Intracorneal ring segment have been proven effective, but again the risk of extrusion and infections is there, and corneal transplantation is penetrating. So why to use collagen cross-linking? Because it hits where the pathogenesis is. The biomechanically weakened cornea is strengthened by introducing the covalent bonds. So we aim to assess the visual outcome of collagen cross-linking and to predict that is the visual outcome predict, like is can we predict the visual outcome. It was a retrospective case record analysis with patients who underwent collagen cross-linking for the indication from April 2017 to March 2019. It performed at a tertiary level hospital with ethical committee clearance taken. So we defined the disease as patient who had undergone refractive surgery, steepening of keratometric indices, more than one diopter in last 12 months, loss of UCVA, and decrease in corneal thickness, which was documented. The data were from our EMR, and if the patient was referred from the older EMR from that treating doctor. Accelerated epithelium off protocol was used, isotonic riboflavin of 0.5% for 20 minutes, and UV exposure we did for 9 milliwatt per centimeter square for 10 minutes. And routine post-operative protocol was used. The measurement outcomes were K-max and K-minimum, the UCVA, BCVA, and MRSC at preoperatively and 3 months post-operatively. And pair t-test was used to analyze the statistical significance, and the p-value was 0.05. So 11 eye of 10 patients were studied, 6 male and 4 female. 72% had undergone LASIK and rest had undergone PRK. The bilateral case was of a female who underwent LASIK 38 months prior to the presentation. And the mean presentation after the surgery was 37 months in LASIK group and PRK was 39 group, not significantly different. So coming to K-max, there was a significant reduction of 1.89 diopters. And as we can see, there is a very strong correlation in the positive correlation. In the changes. Similarly, in K minimum, again, there is a very strong positive correlation with change of minus 1.2 diopter, which was clinically significant. Coming to UCVA, the change was significant, but as we can see, the correlation is not very strong. In the BCVA also, there was a gain of 0.14 logMAR unit, which was significant, but again, the correlation was not at all strong. And the reduction in MRSC was 1.32 diopters, which was significant. But again, as we can see, there is a very poor correlation. So baseline demography was in agreement with Ricaws et al. Study, where two-thirds patient had undergone LASIK, similar to our study. We could not define, we could not calculate the predictive score as the most of the patient were referred from outer centers. The collagen cross-linking did result in significant reduction, which was not very similar to early keratoconus, but we can change. And then significant improvement in UCVA and BCVA were noted. The MRSC also improved, but we can't predict that because there was a very poor correlation, so we can't predict. So the limitation of the study was a very short follow-up retrospective analysis. It was not a prospective study design. And the presence of pre-existing risk factor we could not assess. So to conclude, collagen cross-linking has been proven effective in halting the progression. We can see there is significant flattening that is happening. But still, if we are going to tell the patient, we can tell that disease will stop, but we can't tell how much of the manifest refractive spherical equivalent we are going to correct with this procedure. So thank you. Thank you for the audience. Thank you.
So what might be the cause for your rectation? Any series you mentioned?
Yes, sir.
What might be the cause for rectation?
Sir, mostly what we concluded that the all the patients were having somewhere around 300, the residual bed thickness 300 to 90 in that range. So there might be, when they were taken up for surgery, they were not properly assessed. The Randleman score was not calculated or that can
be. Has been reported to be with epi off. Collagen cross-linking using the Dresden protocol with or without intracorneal ring segments depending upon the severity. So in this paper, I'm going to discuss an innovative technique of management of smile ectasia using tissue addition. And this tissue comes from the smile-derived lenticules, basically from another patient who is undergoing smile. And we take these patients' lenticules and also combine them with pocket cross-linking. So this is a prospective exploratory study. It's still undergoing. Of course, you cannot have a lot of ectasia patients, so that's why our number is less. We have 5 eyes of 4 patients with a mean age of 25.8 years. And we have tried this technique for mild to moderate degrees of smile ectasia. And this technique is essentially based on a technique which we published 4 years ago. And this technique was called FILLY, where we use this technique for treatment of keratoconus, basically. And we use the smile lenticules and combine with cross-linking. So in post-refractive surgery, eye ectasia can be considered as development of keratoconus. So we thought we can apply the same concept for managing smile ectasia as well. So we obtained IRB approval and also informed consent from the patients as well as donor, and we did serology for HIV, hepatitis and VDRL. These patients were smile patients, and both the procedures were planned on the same day, the smile of the donor patient and the tissue addition of the recipient patient was performed on the same day. And how we select these lenticules is basically depending upon the spherical equivalent of the ectatic eye. So suppose the ectatic eye has a spherical equivalent of 2.5. So you take the donor lenticule of around 2.5 to up to 3 diopters. So this is how the lenticule of the donor is prepared. So the lenticule is punched in the center using a 3 millimeter trephine. So this gives us a donut shaped tissue. And this is the recipient eye. You already have a smile pocket. You just need to go in and open the pocket and inject some riboflavin. And then you just implant this tissue, donut shaped tissue, in the pocket and center it onto the center of the pupil. And followed by this, the eye undergoes accelerated cross-linking in pocket. So we are not removing the epithelium. This is cross-linking in pocket, so patients are very comfortable. And the protocol we use is 18 milliwatts for 5.8 minutes using delivering an energy of 6.3 millijoules. That's the final energy. So these are some of the cases which we treated using this technique. This is case one, 24-year-old female. She had moderate myopia in both the eyes. 3 years and 3 months later, she developed ectasia in the left eye. And you can see this is a frank ectasia, and her corrected vision was 618 parts. This was the pre-op topography, and we could see that it was actually a case of form frustic keratoconus, which we had actually not missed, but it was not considered because this was one of our initial cases where we thought smile may be better, so it may be okay. Patient had a good RST, but topography was not normal, and this patient had ectasia. So what we did the tissue addition. This is 12 months result. You can see there's a 4.5 diopter flattening. The first map is the post-op map, and the second one is the pre-op, and this is the difference map showing a 4.5 diopter flattening in the steep K. This is OCT showing very stable lenticule, and the corrected vision also improved from 618 to 69 parts. This is case two, young male with moderate refraction in a myopia in both the eyes. Pre-op topography was actually normal. You can see this is the bad display also, which is also normal. This patient also had ectasia in both the eyes after 3 years, and he had a clear history of eye rubbing. Patient accepted that he was rubbing his eyes, and this was ectasia in the right eye, and this is in the left eye. And post tissue addition, in the right eye, you can see there's a flattening of 6.2 diopters in the steep K, and improvement in the CDVA, and the left eye also flattening of 5 diopters, and improvement in CDVA from 612 to 69 parts. And this is the patient who came to us for second opinion. The patient had very high myopia, and she developed ectasia in the left eye. And this patient also underwent tissue addition, and she improved in her corrected vision to 6x6, and there was a flattening of almost 4.5 diopters for this case. So essentially, what this procedure does is that in your keratocone, in ectasia, you have a central steep part and a flatter mid-peripheral part. And when you add a donut-shaped tissue, it causes steepening in the mid-peripheral part and a relative flattening in the center. So it just acts like a filler. And when you do a pocket cross-linking, it also helps in stabilization of the ectasia. So to conclude, a combined tissue addition with cross-linking appears to be a feasible option to treat smile ectasia. It potentially improves quality of vision by improving corneal shape and reducing abrasions. There is no risk of infections like your intra-stromal rings, and no pain due to delayed healing. As in conventional cross-linking. However, you still need longer follow-ups to establish long-term safety and efficacy of this procedure. Thank you.
How do you preserve these lenticules?
We don't preserve, sir. We
immediately
on the same day.
The same day you can plan.
We already have the data of the recipient patient, and we wait for classes of high-volume smile centers. So we always have patients, so as soon as we have a patient whose lenticule will be matching with the recipient, so we plan the procedure accordingly.
Do you consider the size of the pupil when implanting these?
No, sir.
No, you don't consider.
Earlier, we were cryopreserving these tissues and using it for hypropia, but then we have seen that with cryopreservation, sometimes the quality of the tissue over long term is not very good. Sometimes you can have some impurities. We did have one patient who had stromal rejection with the cryopreserved tissue. So we stopped doing that. So now we are using this fresh stent.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
So when actually, Dr. Brar, you started presentation, I had two questions in my mind. What happened to the donor recipient match? And I think you have answered that question in your presentation. And the second was my thing, how this is going to behave as far as the rejection, long-term or short-term rejection. Like for keratoplasty, I think we have clear guidelines as these are the short-term rejections and long-term rejections. How are, what is going to happen with this stromal graft?
We've actually, as I said, only one, we had one case in our hypropia series where out of 40 eyes, we had only one patient where there was a rejection-like picture. That also happened late. So the good thing about this procedure is that it's a reversible procedure. You can always go back and remove this lenticule. The patient goes back to the original refraction. But generally, our observation is that we have not seen any case of rejection so far in our keratocona series and with these five eyes treated. Thank you.
Now I'll call upon for keynote address, Dr. Ritika Dalal, AIOS Shiv Prasad Hardia Award, Next Generation LASIK Surgery Based on Bowman's Topography, Basic.
Good afternoon. I'll be presenting on the Next Generation LASIK Surgery Based on Bowman's Topography. I have no financial interest. So these are the various epithelial maps, and these are their corresponding topographies. All of them have a refractive error of approximately minus 3 with minus 1 at 180. So if we operated on these patients, would they all have the same outcome? Let's take, for example, this patient with normal K1s and K2. And when we operated on this patient, they had an optimal outcome. A similar looking topography with similar Ks had a suboptimal outcome. So why was this the case? We had to literally dig deeper. It was because the epithelium was masking a steeper Bowman's. So from literature, we know that the epithelium can actually act as a great confounder on what is lying underneath. So the current available devices do not dissociate the epithelium from the Bowman's. Herein comes the need for Bowman's topography. So what is this Bowman's topography and why is it important? So let's start with how we obtain it. From the ASOCT, and with the help of edge detection software, we get the anterior surface as well as the Bowman surface. And then we get curvatural data of the anterior epithelium interface and the epithelium Bowman's interface. And then with ray tracing technology and Zernike's analysis, we calculate the aberrations. So when we are undergoing refractive surgery, if the topography and the Bowman's curvature match with a good epithelium, we generally get favorable outcomes. However, if the topography and the Bowman's don't match and there's epithelial thickness, the outcomes can be unfavorable or something we're not imagining. So is this the first time this has been done? No, Gattinil et al. Has done Bowman's topography. However, in their study, they had to remove the epithelium and then during surgery, go take the patient and get the Bowman's topography. So it was intraoperative and invasive. So the aim of our surgery was to assess changes in visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, and ocular aberrations between LASIK and Bowman's assisted in situ keratomelusis or basic eyes. As I mentioned, the methodology, we took the anterior OCT scans, we got the anterior surface and the Bowman surface, and the tangential and the axial curvatural data. And then with the help of ray tracing and Zernike's analysis, we calculated the aberrations. 130 eyes of 65 patients were included, which had stable refraction and a residual stromal bed of more than 250 microns were willing to undergo the study. And we excluded any patients with previous ocular surgery or scars or who were uncooperative. And then one eye, conventional LASIK was done, and the other eye, LASIK following Bowman's topography or basic was done. The follow-up was done at 1 week, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, after, during which the visual acuity, aberrometric outcomes, and the contrast sensitivity for these patients was seen. So preoperative characteristics between the both eyes was the same. in visual outcomes, both LASIK and basic group, they increased by 2 lines, but they were not statistically similar between the two groups. Even contrast sensitivity improved in both the groups, but they were similar between the two eyes. And abrasions were comparable between the LASIK and the basic eyes. However, the spherical abrasions was more increased in the basic eyes. So both the LASIK and basic had excellent outcomes, but there was a greater change in the ocular SA in the basic eyes as compared to the LASIK eyes, and this needed to be evaluated further, because with abrasions, vision and contrast unchanged, a small change in K value can alter the SA drastically. And we know that lower ocular SA leads to better intermediate and near vision by improving the depth of focus. So when a laser machine fires the lasers on a topography assuming K, X and Y, then there is peripheral loss of energy. However, if we trick the machine into thinking that the cornea is steeper than it actually is, so say X plus 2 and Y plus 1.5, then the rays are equidistant and there is no peripheral loss of energy. So keeping this in mind, we operated on a 43-year-old male and we did one eye basic surgery, which was 2 diopters steeper, and the other eye conventional LASIK. So post-operatively, we saw that the right eye, which basic was done, was 66N6, and the left eye, which had normal LASIK done, was 66N10. So this is basically a proof of concept that Bowman's topography-based correction was safe in epithelial and topographically healthy corneas. It's an ongoing trial to do this in pre-pressed biopic age group, where altering the curvature can play a significant role in changing the spherical abrasions and the depth of focus. So we don't need Fresbiond or any other lasers to achieve this. And in irregular epithelial maps, the Bowman's may be different than the topographies, as in cases of long-term contact lens wearers. So we should keep this in mind. And in keratoconic eyes, it can be useful in topo-guided treatments too. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you for your good presentation. Now we will move on to another paper. I invite Dr. Sanket Patnakar, who is going to present on effect of decentration on spherical aberrations and visual quality with bilateral diffractive multifocals.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to present at AISC 2020. So I'll be presenting my paper on effect of decentration on spherical aberrations and visual quality with bilateral diffractive multifocal IOLs. So a diffractive multifocal IOL is a marvel in IOL engineering. It is based on Higgins' Fresnel principle, where microsteps are made on the surface of the optic of the IOL, and these microsteps are of a specific phase delay, usually half of wavelength. So when light encounters these steps, it is directed equally between the distance and near focal points for all pupil diameters. So if centered properly, it will give you optimum vision for both distance and near. But if decentered, it might lead to photic phenomenon and reduced contrast sensitivity. So a number of studies have been conducted before which have tried to attempt to get a tolerable limit of decentration for unilateral multifocal IOLs, but not a conclusive study has attempted that in the bilaterally implanted multifocal IOLs of the diffractive kind. So keeping that question in mind, we aimed a study to analyze the effect of decentration on spherical aberrations in patients implanted with bilateral aspheric diffractive multifocal IOL, and also to assess the patient satisfaction levels after their implantation. So it was a prospective cross-sectional study which included 36 patients who underwent phacoemulsification and implantation of diffractive aspheric multifocal IOL in both the eyes. It was conducted between August 2017 and May 2019 at a tertiary eye care center in South India. So the patients underwent visual acuity and refraction, thorough ocular examination and A-scan biometry both pre and post-operatively, and also ray tracing aberrometry was done using iTrace, where the aberrations and also the decentration was noted based on angle alpha distance, which was the distance between the center of the limbus and the visual axis. Based on that, a cutoff of 0.25 millimeter decentration was taken. The patient were then subjected to visual function index 14 questionnaire, which includes 14 questions based on the quality of life they have after the surgery, and is validated by a psychometric assessment method such as a rash analysis. So the MFIL used was a Technis multifocal one-piece IOL. So coming to the results, a total of 72 eyes of 36 patients were included in the study. And based on the cutoff of 0.25, there were two groups which were allotted. Group 1, which had patients with bilateral decentration of 0.25 to 0.35 millimeter, and group 2, which had decentration more than 0.35 millimeter. So the mean age of patients was 56.88 years, and mean preoperative distance visual acuity was 0.41 logMAR. Coming to the comparison of visual acuity and MRSE pre and post-op, at 1 month post-operative visit of the second eye surgery, we saw a significant improvement in the logMAR and also the MRSE in all the patients. In the ray tracing abrometry, the mean decentration of the study population was 0.378 millimeter, and the number of the decentration, mean decentration in the group 1 population was 0.26 millimeter, and in the group 2 population was 0.44 millimeter. Coming to aberrations, in the entire study population, the aberrations were more in the group 2, which had a decentration of more than 0.35 millimeter in both the eyes, but this difference was not statistically significant. Coming to the visual satisfaction, the mean visual satisfaction level in the study population was 98.06%, and 19 patients out of the 36 were symptomatic on the questionnaire, and difficulty in night driving and difficulty in reading small prints were the dominant symptoms noted. So correlating these parameters in the complete study sample, we saw a negative correlation of decentration and visual acuity in all the parameters, but this was not statistically significant. Coming to individual groups, both decentration and visual quality were more negatively correlated in the group 2, that is where the decentration was more than 0.35 millimeter in both the eyes, and it was statistically significant in higher order, lower order, and spherical aberrations in the group 2. So what we conclude is spherical aberrations were more in the group with decentration more than 0.35 millimeter, and 50% of the subjects were symptomatic on the questionnaire. Also, there was a negative correlation between the quality of life and decentration and aberrations in the overall study population. And looking at the individual groups, there was a negative correlation which was more in the group with decentration more than 0.35 millimeter in both the eyes. So what we already knew was that aspherical of both refractive and diffractive multifocal IOL is capable of countering the spherical aberrations encountered post-operatively. And aberrations and visual symptoms become prominent if decentration is more than 0.75 to 1 millimeter in unilateral cases, which is seen in the review of literature. But what this study has is, though the mean visual satisfaction was 98%, but in bilaterally implanted diffractive multifocal IOLs, visual quality suffers if decentration is more than 0.25 millimeter in both the eyes. And also, more is the decentration, higher are the total higher order and lower order aberrations. But the limitations of the study were that a longer follow-up maybe a larger sample size would have been helpful in determining long-term effect of decentration on visual outcomes and aberrations. And if the study sample was more, we could have correlated that with modular transfer function and OSI. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. Any questions?
The next talk is by Dr. Geetansha Sachdev, but as Dr. Geetansha is not here, Dr. Shreyas is presenting the paper, Analysis of Visual Outcome Following Cyclotorsion, Compensation versus Non-in-Smile for Astigmatism.
Respected judges and my friends, at the outset, I'd like to thank the judges for allowing me to present as Geetansha is now 36 weeks pregnant. So I'll be talking to you all on analysis of visual outcomes following cyclotorsion compensation versus none in SMILE in eyes with high astigmatism. I have no financial disclosure. So why is this cyclotorsion compensation important? As we all know, cyclotorsion happens in two ways, one from the sitting position to lying down position, and as well in a SMILE where it constitutes a dock that from a pre-dock position to post-dock itself can induce a slight amount of torsion. Now, the average cyclotorsion is usually in the studied population is about 3 degrees, can vary from 0 to 12. But in high astigmatisms, this has a significant effect where anything more than 4 degrees of rotation can induce an undercorrection of 14%. And as we all know, there is currently no technical support available or no cyclotorsion compensation available in SMILE. So the purpose of the study was to compare visual outcomes between eyes which underwent cyclotorsion compensation versus none in SMILE for high astigmatism. It was a prospective interventional case series between June 18 to May 2019. Our inclusion criteria included age above 18 and the usual refractive criteria for SMILE, but we included only patients with a manifest cylinder of greater than 1.5 diopter, which had to have bilaterally high cylinder and a cyclotorsion of greater than 5 degrees. I'll allude to how we did that in subsequent slides. Exclusion criteria, again, the usual exclusion criteria for any refractive surgery, including hyperopia, which cannot be corrected with SMILE. So it was a contralateral eye study. In all the eyes, in eyes where we did the cyclotorsion compensation, as well as where we didn't do the cyclotorsion compensation, the marking was done. And as you can see here, a graticule was used, and then subsequently an onlay protractor was used to measure the amount of cyclotorsion that the patient had. And only eyes which had greater than 5 degrees of cyclotorsion was included, because we wanted to measure the subset of patients with higher degrees of cyclotorsion with high astigmatism. So this is just the video, This is the video showing cyclotorsion compensation. The initial marks were made at the slit lamp at the 7 millimeter zone. And you'll see these marks come into play as the laser is being delivered. As you can see, one mark here and the other mark here. And as the dock goes off, as the suction goes off, you'll see the eye rotate back into position. So essentially in eyes where we were doing the cyclotorsion compensation, we were rotating the graticule to compensate with the 0180 mark as well as the 270 degree inferior mark. It was a triple centration technique which is being used. The graticule was rotated in eyes where we did the cyclotorsion compensation, but in the contralateral eye where we didn't do the cyclotorsion compensation, there was no rotation of the graticule. So we did the usual refractive examinations, visual acuity refraction, IOP, and looking at the results, these were 60 eyes of 30 patients, where 30 eyes in each group where cyclotorsion was done and no compensation was done in the other group. The preoperative being contralateral eye study were similar across both the groups. In the study group, as you can see here, in the preoperative period, we included only eyes with high intraop cyclotorsion, about 7 degrees in the cyclotorsion compensation and 7.24 in the no compensation. The cylindrical median as well was quite high, with about 2.5 diopters each. So when we looked at the postoperative outcomes, we used the ALPINS criteria, which is the standard for looking at any astigmatism outcome studies. As you can see here, whether it was the surgically induced astigmatism, the difference error, and most importantly, the correction index, was no different between the group which underwent the compensation versus the one where there was no compensation done. There was a slight overcorrection, as you can see here, a 1.02 and 1.01 in either group, but there was absolutely no statistical difference. This is again the diagrammatic representation of the ALPINS criteria, and as you can see here, the data is well crowded with very few outliers in both the groups. So just to look at some of the studies which have been published earlier, Ganesh et al. Looked at a cohort where they looked at this with high astigmatism in 81 eyes, but they did not have a control arm where it was compared with eyes which did not undergo cyclotorsion. There's another study which looked at it in a comparative manner, but the issue was they included eyes with very low astigmatism. And as you can see here, in eyes which actually underwent cyclotorsion rotation, they showed the actual torsion was just 0.6 degree versus 3.2 in the group which did not have cyclotorsion compensation. So again, that was not comparable groups. Again, the third study, which did improve slightly better outcomes, but they also looked only at very low degrees of cyclotorsion compensation. So we have included eyes with high astigmatism as well as a higher degree of cyclotorsion and have done it using this triple centration technique. But as of today, we did not see any significant difference between either group. Possible reasons could be that subtle variations in the marking itself. As we all know, as it applies even with toric IOL, an absolute error of 2.8 degrees available. Mean cyclotorsion in SMILE is about 5.65, and so probably is not giving enough satisfactory results. So correcting high astigmatism continues to remain a challenge. Manual cyclotorsion compensation, as of date, it seems to be ineffective. Newer inbuilt compensatory mechanisms, as in excimer lasers, might be the future path for SMILE cases with high astigmatism. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
Next speaker is Dr. Gairik Kundu. He is going to present next generation 3D epithelium thickness mapping tool to assess wound healing post refractive surgery.
Good afternoon to one and all. Doubtless, I'd like to thank AIOS for giving me this opportunity. Can we have the slide, please? Yeah. So I'll be speaking on next generation mapping of 3D epithelium thickness, a novel tool to assess wound healing post refractive surgery. Now, why is it important? Epithelium can, in fact, throw light to multiple things which, you know, we sometimes miss post epithelium, post any refractive surgery. So thereby, what is the need? Why do we actually need to study healing patterns post any refractive surgery? Now, I know I'm not in an orthopedics lecture, but you know, post any person injuring himself, having a fracture, there are various ways the bone actually heals. You know, some normal, some abnormal, some aberrant. Likewise, the similar ways post epithelial, post any refractive surgery, there are multiple ways in which an epithelium can actually heal. And this, in fact, can help us in prognosticating and defining outcomes post any refractive surgery. So what we did is, we wanted to integrate and use our knowledge on artificial intelligence, our existing knowledge on algorithms, and whether linking artificial intelligence to refractive surgeries help us in improving outcomes. Now, we did a retrospective analysis at our center where we looked at 200 eyes, 50 of them undergoing PRK, 50 undergoing a transepithelial PRK, 50 undergoing LASIK, and 50 undergoing SMILE. So we used the standard anti-segment OCT OptiView, which looked at the air epithelium and the epithelium Bowman's interface. We then ran a Zernike's analysis on these on the epithelium thickness distribution and arrived at a novel index. The novel index was basically the epithelium Zernike's index. What we derived was that the ratio of the constant to the sum of the lower order and the higher order aberrations, in fact, is statistically significantly different from each one of these groups. And assessing these aberrometric indices post-epithelial, post-refractive surgery can in fact give us an idea as to what refractive surgery the patient has undergone. So we basically classified these indices as to whether they had local changes or whether they had global changes in the thickness of the distribution. So what we found was that if you look at the increase in the central epithelium thickness post-operatively, it was similar between the surgeries. And when we looked at the aberrometric indices, like I said, the epithelium Zernike's indices is what we have coined. We looked at the higher order and lower order aberrations. It was increased in cases of SMILE LASIK as well as in the trans-PR case. But when we looked at the manual PR case, the lower order aberrations increased. So how did we actually build this? So we used our these epithelial indices and integrated that into something known as a decision tree classifier. Now, a decision tree classifier, in fact, one of them is a random forest classifier. It's an existing AI algorithm where there are discriminant nodes. Now, each one of these nodes, we give a cutoff value for a variable. Now, in this case, we're looking at epithelial healing patterns post-refractive surgery. Now, if a value is greater than that of what is set in the AI algorithm, it then goes into the next node. So random forest, in fact, picks up random variables and helps in classifying. So in this case, it was this epithelial indices was helping us in classifying the type of refractive surgeries the patient was undergoing. And using this, we were actually able to arrive at a post-operative probable healing pattern of epithelium, which could in fact help us in figuring out outcomes post-refractive surgery. So we use something known as a confusion matrix, which was a part of the AI algorithm which we used. And what we found out was that to almost 90% of the times, it was actually correctly able to pick up what type of surgery just by analyzing the aberration profile of these aberration indices, what we call the epithelial Zernike's indices is what we have hypothesized. So like I said, this concept of machine learning, many of the today's era, artificial intelligence has taken over. So utilizing our retrospective analysis of epithelium indices, we were in fact successfully able to predict outcomes in terms of epithelial healing post-refractive surgery. So what exactly can it help us in? It can actually help us in creating algorithms to predict post-operative healing patterns and to choose the most appropriate refractive surgery based on the patient's existing epithelial indices which exist. Where are the clinical applications? This is in fact early work. We still have to validate this in terms of a larger amount of patients. But we've looked at patients with unusual keratometries and tried our AI algorithm, and it was able to predict what type of surgery would be most suitable in terms of visual outcomes. We also looked at patients with suspicious topographies and whether integrating this and integrating the epithelial healing patterns, whether it was able to pick up whether it was ectatic or not, and it did to some extent help us in predict that as well. Another indication was especially epithelial regression. You know, in these patients, patients do come back post-operative or post-refractive surgery. Epithelial healing and epithelial hypertrophy could be an indication as to the cause of regression. And using AI algorithms, we were able to predict whether there was a regression or not. So this is, in fact, early work. We have extrapolated this index into as well as epithelium healing post in keratoconic patients. We have started looking at epithelium post cross-linking as well. We looked at 350 patients, and we have also looked at topographic parameters. This is our next field of work, and integrating this into our existing knowledge on the epithelial Zernike's indices, whether we are actually able to differentiate normals from a form frustrated keratoconus. That's our next field of work. Now, this was early results. What is important is that our next step is to actually integrate our existing knowledge in artificial intelligence, integrate that with demographics and biomechanics as well as topography, and thereby helping in improving outcomes. So what we actually know is that ASOCT does help us in dissociate epithelium from topography, but this was a more precise way of mapping the epithelium, and AI in fact could be an additive tool in increasing accuracy of post-operative outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you. I invite the next speaker, Dr. Prerana Ahuja. She is going to present a paper on the importance of psychological and personality assessment and its impact on refractive surgery's outcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking about the importance of psychological and personality assessment on the refractive surgery outcomes. So we decided to undertake this study in the first place because we realized that last year there was a very sad case about a journalist who committed suicide post her LASIK surgery because she could not deal with the recovery period complications. And when we started searching online, we saw that there's a lot of negative perception about LASIK and refractive surgeries available online. And what are we missing exactly then? Because we have the best of machines, we have experienced surgeons doing it, we have advanced eye trackers, accurate lasers, then why can't we yet guarantee patient satisfaction? So currently when a patient is unhappy, we do evaluate in detail their cyclorefraction, their topography, aberrometry, as well as the orthoptics. But if all of this is normal, then can we only give lubricating as a placebo and keep telling them to get better later on? That's not how we can always tell a patient. And this is because we forget to see the patient as a whole, understand their mindset, not just the organic visual pathway. So our research question was that can we determine if a patient's personality will affect the post-surgical satisfaction? And if so, then should we have a different approach for such patients? So first, we had to find out how do we assess personality. We searched online for any questionnaires available freely from the ISANC personality inventory. It's freely available online. It's a 57-question yes or no questionnaire, which the patient has to fill in, helps them assess the patient's personality. So it gives us different scores. One is the extroversion score, then we have the neuroticism score, and then we have a falsification score, which tells us how if the patient is sort of lying to us to cover up a personality trait. So we do get four temperaments out of it, based on it, which are stable temperaments are such as the phlegmatic and the sanguine personalities, and the neurotic temperaments are the melancholic and the choleric personality traits. So once we had the questionnaire in our hand, we started our study. Our first arm was a retrospective arm design, and the second was a prospective screening of all our refractive patients. In the first arm, we asked 250 patients who had already undergone refractive surgery at 1 month post-op to fill out the quality of life questionnaire, which helped assess how they felt their vision was while doing different tasks. We found that 243 patients were happy with their outcomes, while 7 were unhappy. So for them, we did do an optical quality analysis as well as ask them to fill out the ISANC personality inventory. We correlated the personality scores with the quality of life, and we found that all 7 patients were either of melancholic or choleric personality types. We did rule out any organic visual causes for dissatisfaction. We found that the eye trace across all the four groups was normal in ocular as well as corneal aberrations. So while we were very happy with the outcomes as surgeons, there was no wow factor for the patient as such. So we thought we should have a new way of dealing with such patients. We now started doing the prospective arm of our study, where we asked 300 patients prior to refractive surgery. When they came to the hospital for screening, they were asked to fill out the EPI questionnaire. And thus, before they even met the doctor, we were already aware of what kind of personality type we were going to be dealing with. And when we knew we were getting a patient of choleric or melancholic type, we had a little different evaluation of what we did. So for these 12 patients who had difficult personalities, we had an increased chair time. We spent more time getting to know their expectations of the surgery. We involved the family in the process so that we can moderate the expectations. We ruled out history of substance abuse, and we did an orthoptic evaluation as well. When we saw we had a lot of red flags noticed in the patient's personality, we did refer them to a psychiatric clinic so we could get clearance from their side as well. And for four patients, we actually opted not to operate at all before we could get clearance. So how do you really apply this? So when you have a patient who has no suspicious traits, you can of course proceed with surgery carefully. If you have a patient who has suspicious behavior, we recommend doing an in-depth counseling and take special or video consents. And when you have a highly suspicious behaving patient, we do seek professional help and only then operate once we get clearance from their end as well. So how can we take this further? We are trying to automate the use of the EPI. So we are working on creating an app, which we'll call the Ophthal Couch app. It brings the EPI to our fingertips. And now when the patient comes to our hospital, we ask them to fill the EPI on our hospital tablet. Once they fill it, they get a thank you for your feedback sort of alert, while the EPI directly links to our EMR, and we know exactly what personality type we are dealing with. So how this helps us in conclusion, helps us predict those patients who will never be satisfied with the surgical outcomes, and in those cases, what protective measures we should take, when to take special precautions, when to do detailed counseling, when to take video consents when possible, and lastly, prevent any unnecessary secondary surgical interventions like recorrections or dry eye interventions, and it reduces the stress for both the patient as well as the doctor. Thank you.
Thank you for your interesting case presentation. Definitely, if you keep more chair time and if you discuss preoperatively, counsel naturally, you know, you can avoid all these things. Thank you.
The seven patients you said were either melancholic or the other category. So that means whosoever was unsatisfied, you have put it in that group. Now the question is, how much was the observer's bias, means your bias, in assessing the patient?
So I actually showed the slide also where we did eye trace for all the patients. We made sure there was no visual cause for the dissatisfaction. And once we knew, if you see our eye trace, we all have equivalent findings. They had good quality outcomes, but they were yet not happy despite having the optical analysis being normal.
Oh, fair. This is very interesting presentation. Now, suppose in your pre-operative assessment, if the patient qualifies to class 4, what are you going to do with those patients? Send it to the other center or what?
No, sir. So for some patients, we did do an orthoptics evaluation. We did special consents. We told the family that this is what's happening and you should be aware. And for four patients, we have actually canceled surgery because we thought it would not be safe for us as well as the patient to undergo the surgery.
So what should you do so for those category of patients?
So we referred them to a psychiatrist for help before we can operate on them.
Very interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now I'll call all presenter for group photo.